important issues, mostly the environment. And we have a, I'd like to just say, we have some sad news today. We have the passing of Ed Garvey. And Ed was a strong advocate for the people. And he was also a fighter that took up very tough fights. And in the coming years, that's what we're going to be asked to do, is take up some very tough fights. And we have to be, we have to stay vigilant, and we have to stay informed. And to that point, I'd like to introduce Betty. And this wonderful diorama, which was made by an art teacher, a retired art teacher. And the issue is high voltage power lines, which are coming to our area. And she'll be talking at the end of the movie about the Driftless Defenders. And so without further ado, Betty.
Okay, Betsy, that's all right. So I'm here with my good friend and neighbor, Deb Ivey, who is the person who made this two-scale diorama, Denise Stronchek. And we met Carrie Friday night. Carrie's back there. And we were having a meeting of our group, which is called Driftless Defenders, and she explained that tonight we were having this meeting called We the People, and that it was about local people, local democracy, and people doing something. So I'm just going to give you a brief blurb on how we started, because I know we've got lots of important things to do, and then at the end, if you want to see our handouts and things. So our group is a grassroots coalition of citizens dedicated to preventing the construction of high-voltage transmission lines through the geologically unique Driftless area of Wisconsin. And we began last May when we and Deb and I and a couple other friends and all our neighbors got letters in our mailbox from American Transmission Company saying they wanted to build towers and transmission lines through our wind tower. Gigantic. To scale on here. Compared to this.
170 feet high. 350 kilowatt voltage spread 345.
So we were all in shock. We love our land, I'm sure as many of you do. We work on it, we play on it, we derive satisfaction from it. It's like it's part of our being, kind of all those things that are really hard to describe. And we were wondering what to do. We decided to call our neighbors together. We sent out an email thinking, oh, maybe we'll get 30 people from the neighborhood. We live in the Pleasant Ridge section of Dodgeville Township, which is near Governor Dodge State Park. So the night of our meeting came, and instead of, we guessed 30 people would come, we got 70 to 80 people, and they came from all over Dodgeville, Blue Mounds, Barnabelle, and Arena. So we decided to start our group. We called ourselves Driftless Defenders. We started educating ourselves. We started going out to the public at parades and events. We created some handouts, which we can go into detail at the end if you want to see, that are behind here. And we basically started spreading the word, because the transmission companies are only required to tell people within 300 feet of these lines, so most people don't know about it. And it's actually something that seriously affects our area property values, not just for people who live with lines on their land, but further than that, tourism, all sorts of, not to mention the conservation and environmental things, plus the cost is huge, and we pay for it on our utility bills. So anyway, we have now grown to be, we have 300 people who receive our monthly newsletter, and then we have 125 people who are on our, we have an active, it's called Google Groups, where you can email to each other within a group. And so those people get regular emails. And so anything else you get from this thing?
Well, I'm an organic farmer, and I'm really concerned with the 150-foot swath that they spray with herbicides and pesticides, which I'm prohibited of use. So that puts me out of business, and I'm not okay with that. So I vehemently oppose this project.
But we'll take some more time at the very end if you want to know more about our group.
Thank you.
So thank you.
So we have a special guest tonight, speaking of progressive champions. I don't think I need to say much more than Jon Erpenbach.
Before I get started into what I'm actually here to talk about, I'm going to talk about Ed for a minute. Ed moved the needle. Ed was very passionate. Ed was extremely funny. I don't know if you know this or not. Wicked, sometimes raunchy, sense of humor. We as a state are going to miss him. Because even though he wasn't in office, he talked to those of us who were. And always had a bright outlook on what could be done, as opposed to us just saying no, which is kind of what we're used to right now, which is too bad. But yeah, we are absolutely going to miss that. We are really going to miss that. The other thing I wanted to say, as far as the power lines go, I'm not a scientist, but I think everything we need for power is produced right here on a farm. And someday we'll figure out how to harness what a farm has, not just manure, but everything else that a farm can produce, produce a lot of our energy. So hopefully someday we'll head down that way as opposed to big power lines that are actually being set up so companies can buy power out west, pass through Wisconsin, and sell it to other states. We're just a pass-through on this right now. We do need an upgrade in our infrastructure in certain places because we are, in some parts of the state, using more power, but that's kind of scary. All right, so local control. That's what I'm here to talk about tonight, what the state's done with. They're really isn't as much local control and local government as there used to be. And to me, the purest form of government, the purest, absolute purest form of government, it's the smallest government, a town board, school board. The more local it gets, believe it or not, in some cases, the more impact it has on your life. And more importantly, the more accountable it can be held. It is very easy to vote a town board member out if you don't like what they're doing, or vote a town board member in if you like what they're doing. Same thing with the school board. But what's happened over time, and it's been really, it's been accelerated, excuse me, recently, is that local boards, whether it be a town board, whether it be a county board, whether it be a school board, city council, village board, they've all lost control. And they've lost control to the state of Wisconsin. And that control was taken by people who made a living out of running for office by saying government is too big. We need to get government out of our lives. Government is just too damn big. And then they turn around and pass legislation and author legislation and slip amendments in the budget that take away local control, and they actually make the state of Wisconsin government bigger. And we have more power than we should have. Zoning, shoreland zoning, was a big change that was made in the budget this last budget cycle, where local units of government had a say. Not so much anymore. They don't. Cost controls, when the state puts caps on how much a school district can spend, that's taking away local control. When the state says how much you can pay a teacher, that's taking away local control. When the state just basically takes away collective bargaining, that's taking away local control. So keep an eye out, especially an ear out. When you hear somebody talk about how government is too big, and usually it's the other side of the aisle that talks about it, they turn around and they introduce legislation to take away local control. And I've always said to my colleagues that if you have an issue with the school district, you should probably run for school board and you shouldn't be in the state senate. Or if you have a issue with the university, which is going to be a target in the state budget again, you probably should get out of the state legislature and see if you can get on the Board of Regents. If you have a problem with what Dane County is doing, you should actually get out of the state senate, move to Dane County, and run for county board. Which, by the way, Dane County, as far as the economy is concerned, without Dane County, Wisconsin would really be struggling right now. I don't know if you've seen the reports lately, but over half of the jobs, 65% of the new jobs recently came out of Dane County. And it's not just Epic, by the way, or Epic. It's all sorts of other businesses. So Dane County is doing something right. Yet the legislature, on a piece of legislation passed by Republicans who don't live in Dane County, authored by a Republican who doesn't live in Dane County, allows towns to opt out of county planning. Now they have to do it by referendum, But there's a piece of legislation that's being introduced to get rid of the referendum, so if the town board wants to opt out, the town board can just do it without going to referendum with people in the township. So local control, you know, is such an important thing. You know, I went to school, that doesn't mean I'm an expert that I know how to run schools. My job as a legislator, a state legislator, is to get funding to local units of government, get funding to school districts, make sure it's as fair as it possibly can be, and then let the school board do what the school board's elected to do. Same thing with the town board, same thing with the city council, same thing with the county board. So, local control is what makes Mount Horeb, it's what makes Cross Plains. It's a board made up of people who live here, some cases born and raised here, some cases recently new to the area, and the legislature shouldn't be taking away their authority. We just shouldn't be. So when you see pieces of legislation coming up, for example, on the Dane County towns opting out of county planning without going to referendum anymore, call the legislature, not just me, not just Sandy. You have a right to call every single legislator and tell them what you think, because they have, their vote has an impact on your life here in Dane County. On statewide issues, you have a right to call every single legislator, not just Sandy and myself, but everybody, because we all have an impact on your life. Even State Senator from Duluth or from Superior has an impact on your life here in Mount Horeb. So stay in touch with us, but at the same time, you have to remain vigilant. Even if you might not like the legislation, even if you might agree with the legislation, but it takes away local control, we need to hear from you. Local control needs to be local. State legislature needs to stay out of county government. We need to stay out of town government. We need to stay out of city government, and we haven't been lately. So please contact all of us. That being said, I'd be happy to answer any questions you have. I've got a listening session coming up Saturday. We're going to talk about my favorite subject, the state budget. It'll be a lot of fun. We're talking about a lot of policy there, not so much politics there. So if you have any political questions or anything else, yes.
Your talk about local control makes me think of the gerrymandering, which is going on, and the maps.
Yep.
Is there anything that can be done to stop the Republicans from once again using our tax money, thousands and thousands of dollars, to support their unconstitutional maps?
So I did this last time. I wrote the lawyers that the legislature hired to do redistricting, because technically I'm a client,
right?
I'm a client. I should have access to what the billing procedures are, how much they're billing, so on, all of it. The maps, before they were adopted by the legislature, I should have access to that because I'm a client of this law firm, but they wouldn't show it to me. It had to go through the majority leader. So I'm going to do it again. I'm going to send the law firm a letter, politely, saying, can I please see this? And, oh, by the way, are you billing me when you read this letter, kind of a thing. So here's what's going on. There is the Republicans have been ordered to draw a new map by November of this year. At the same time, the Attorney General has made it very, very clear he's going to appeal this, which means the U.S. Supreme Court. Whether or not the U.S. Supreme Court takes it up, who knows? But in the meantime, the legislature, again, it's not the legislature, it's the Republicans, it's the majority party, hired a law firm. They capped their costs at however many hundreds of thousands of dollars to redraw the map and make it constitutional. This underscores something that I've been saying since I've been in office, and I've introduced legislation, or I've been on legislation ever since I've been in office. The legislature should not be drawing the map. Democrats, by the way, had a chance to change this, and we didn't. The majority leader, no matter from what party, they have a responsibility to protect the majority, but not this. It should be drawn by a panel of three judges, or the state's legislative reference bureau should draw it. And the legislature has to adopt it in the end, but we shouldn't be doing it. It's the most self-serving thing a legislative body does. And if you take a look at our districts around the state, my state senate district, for example, in the last redistricting map, in the last census, I had the most amount of growth. Out of all of the senate districts, I had the most amount of growth in the senate district I represent. And it's because I do a really good job. So people were just moving. I know better. It's epic, and other places like epic. So you would think that my district would have actually gotten smaller. It got bigger. And I'm not certain of the number, but at least 40% of the people who are in the 27th Senate District are new. I went from basically Dane County, parts of Madison, Greene County, a little bit of Lafayette County, a little bit of Rock County. I now have No Madison, Western Dane County, Columbia County, Sauk County, half of Greene County, a little bit of Iowa County. It doesn't make a lot of sense. And I realize that if you start at one end of the state, it's going to have an effect on how the district looks at the other end of the state. And I do realize that these maps are written for a political advantage. But here's what happens. We are divided as a state, very much divided, right? I went to Waukesha County and gave a speech, three, four, 5 months ago. And I start off by saying I'm part of this foreign exchange program. I'm from Dane County. They chuckled nervously, but they did. Redistricting, along with policy, has led to the division we have in this state. Republican seats got more Republican, Democratic seats got more Democratic, marginal seats under this map got more Republican. So and Congress actually is worse, by the way. I don't think we're ever going to have a competitive congressional race in my lifetime, unless redistricting changes at the federal level, too. Mark's district got more Democratic, Paul Ryan's district got more Republican, Ron Kind's district got more Democratic, Jim Sensenbrenner's district, believe it or not, got more Republican. The northern seat, which is Sean Duffy, got more Republican. So this has led to just isolating us even more. If anything, ideally you'd come up with a formula that would have seats be essentially 50-50 on the numbers. I know it's not possible, but if you could, imagine the debate on the issues. The best issues, the best candidate would win. Now a lot of money would be introduced, and we have to change that too on disclosure, but if things were equal, we'd actually be debating the issues. And hopefully we'll get to that point. And hopefully the federal court decision will be upheld if it gets to the Supreme Court. But in the meantime, there has to be a new map. I just hope I live in my district. Yeah.
Yes. I'm wondering, I'm absolutely perplexed by Brad Schimmel's decision to appeal this. And I'm wondering if you can tell me, because I don't know, what his rationale is. Well, how is he justified?
I can do that with one sentence. The Republican Attorney General.
Right.
This is all politics. It has nothing more than I can guarantee you if he were a Democrat, he probably wouldn't be appealing it. But he is a Republican Attorney General. And this is, maps are as political as it gets. And even though you've had a couple of decisions now on this particular issue, it's pretty clear the map is not constitutional. It's pretty clear, but again, his political leanings tell him I need to appeal this. So that's
so he doesn't have an equitable responsibility here to the citizens of.
I would tend to think that the Attorney General looks at the law first and then determines whether or not the ruling was right or wrong. I'm not shocked that he thought this was wrong. But again, he's a Republican, and he's a partisan. He is, he's elected to a partisan office, so that's why he's doing it. Yes, sir.
First, a comment. Funny how the communist county is responsible for most of the jobs growth in the state. That aside,
can I just say one thing about that? And I know you're not calling us that, but those who do have no clue what happens here in Dane County. And those who do should not be making a living off of talk radio in Dane County. Dane County is a wonderful place. And there are some of the best people and best ideas come out of this county. And I'm offended. We are as American gets. Do we have different ideas on how we deal with health care, how we deal with social issues than the majority of Waukesha County does? Yeah, maybe, but that doesn't mean we can't talk. So I didn't mean to.
Sorry. I ask this in all innocence. It used to be that local control was a Republican talking point.
Yeah.
10 years
it
ago.
It still is, by the way.
And now it's flipped.
No, so maybe that's an answer. The Republicans run against big government.
Yeah, so I was going to ask, what is different about the issue now that they're able to flip-flop on that, or is it just pure hypocrisy?
Well, the developers don't like dealing with local units of government when it comes to building big developments along lake shores. So let's just go to our state, northern state senator and get something passed dealing with shoreline zoning. The potato growers in central Wisconsin don't like dealing with, first of all, the DNR, and then secondly, dealing with local units of government. So let's just go to the state of Wisconsin. They'll introduce a piece of legislation, which they did today or yesterday, basically blowing the lid on high-capacity wells. That's what they do. And again, these are people who run against big government, they run against Madison, but more importantly, big government. And some of these particular pieces of legislation, especially the impact it has on northern Wisconsin, the state senators from those areas voted in favor of it, and in some cases authored it. And it was against the best interest of that, certainly environmentally, of that particular part of the state. The mining legislation is a great example of that. What is said and what is done are two completely different things. I'm running against big government because that'll get me elected. And then as soon as I get to government, I'm going to make my little kingdom bigger. So, yes?
You were talking about gerrymandering before. As an update on gerrymandering, the people that filed the original suit that was successful when they were in front of the federal judges, they are, I believe, also filing friends of the court groups and continuing with that dream in their group. So because the legislators are filing on their behalf and the state attorney general is filing on behalf of us, I suppose, there's two friends of the court group. I myself filed, have registered with the ACLU to file a friend of the court group as just a simple voter. So if you actually are interested in the gerrymandering issue, you could, as an individual or as a group, do the same thing.
Yes, how you doing?
Pretty good. Following up on the development disconnect between like what's going on in Wayne County and the rest of the state, has anyone actually looked at how the money flows? Because what I found interesting, and since we work a lot in rural Wisconsin outside of Dane County, is that the perception is that the money is flowing from there into Dane County. And yet, when I work on various formulas, whether it's a school tax formula, whether it's a child care formula, whether it's welfare to work formulas, almost every formula I work on shows that those formulas work better in rural Wisconsin and that the money probably is flowing the other direction. And it seems to be a concept that might be necessary to try to correct.
Are you talking about tax dollars?
Yeah.
Yeah. More tax dollars flow out
than in.
Yeah. But in cases like funding for roads and K-12 education, it flows in, then it flows, gets distorted, then it flows back out.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, it is, and I was looking at a breakdown of some of the counties that receive Badger Care or are get their health care through the Affordable Care Act. Just on a percentage basis alone, it'd be surprising, especially in more rural counties.
They're bigger than Milwaukee.
Yeah,
on a percentage basis.
Well, that's
Medicare and
their rural. Well, that is a PR problem, but it's also something where, again, legislators who make a living talking about how bad Madison is, how many cheats are on food stamps, how many people are lazy and don't want to work, that kind of, those people get elected. And then they pass legislation limiting Badger Care, for example, and it actually hurts their constituents. They don't look at the numbers. I show them the numbers, they just don't care. Because, again, it's an overall arching theme I've seen legislators, Republican legislators in rural areas, not all of them, but some of them, vote to take away benefits, not realizing that they are disproportionately affecting their district more than they're affecting Milwaukee County.
Yeah.
But they think they're going after Milwaukee County. Yeah. It's just mind-boggling. Yes?
Yes, a great deal of municipalities have passed referendums on Move to Amend,
mm-hmm.
United to Amend, which deals with money in politics and corporate citizenship. And every session, it seems like we try to get this as a statewide referendum.
Yep.
And is there a push this session? And chances, I mean, because we've got almost half the state voted on this.
Right.
And by a 70% or over margin, it's passed. Mm-hmm. It's pretty obvious that the people want this.
Yeah.
So, is there any chance that we can get this on a statewide level, and do you have any suggestions how to go about doing that?
Speaking of local control, and I'll answer your question, there's also legislation that Republicans want to say when local units of government can and cannot have referendums. Anyway, just throwing that out there. Anyway, the reality of getting it on a statewide ballot is not going to happen just because of the way the legislative makeup is. Doesn't mean we can't introduce it, doesn't mean we can't hold a press conference on it, doesn't mean we can't include it in the newsletters we send out, the electronic newsletters. Doesn't mean I can't talk about it at town hall meetings, listening sessions that we do. So yeah, we certainly can introduce it, get some attention to it. There are people who have given up in this state on campaign finance reform simply because they just don't believe it's going to happen. It's a high priority for them. And some of the people I deal with say, well, it doesn't show up in polling. It's because sometimes people have given up. Not everybody, but some people have just given up on this issue. All you need to do on Citizens United, and that the Supreme Court decision gave states the right to do this, is disclosure. We don't need to totally upend the thing. If we passed a piece of legislation requiring all groups to disclose where their money is coming from, that corporate money would dry up so quickly because corporations don't want to be seen as one side or the other because, believe it or not, it's bad for business. And we have seen progressives and Democrats change corporate opinion on things. You saw, I don't know if you watched the Super Bowl, some of the commercials during the Super Bowl were sending a loud message to the new administration out in Washington. So if we had disclosure, and we passed it in the Senate, it was my bill, it passed the Senate, Governor Doyle was going to sign it, the Assembly of Democrats didn't bring it up at the last second, and then that was the last time we had the majority. If we just had disclosure, businesses would not want to be publicly identified as with one side or the other. And disclosure would go a long, long way. Anything else? Yeah.
Would you be willing to reintroduce that legislation then? To require disclosure?
Yeah, well, yeah. We do it all the time. No, we do it all because I'm thinking one of these times they might be sleeping and you just kind of sleep. You know? Once in a while, that might happen. Yeah.
I have a specific question about the lead abatement program in the pipes going to people's houses. Would I talk to you about that, or would I talk to someone else to ask that question?
Talk to somebody in my staff about it. Are you talking about funding, or?
Well, if you were a wealthy person and lived in this community, mm-hmm. You couldn't get lead abatement. But if you were a wealthy person that lived in this community and you owned 30 units in a community where the average income was below a certain amount, you can have all those units serviced on taxpayer money.
Okay.
But you can live in this community and be on a fixed income, and this community's average income is too high for you to take advantage of that. So in my mind, that's what leads to gentrification in a community like this. It's what forces people out.
Right. So we should sit down and talk about it and try to come up with something.
I would love to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else? I got time for one last question, and I have to go. Yes, sir.
First of all, if I'm right, Schultz is one of those people that put out the challenge for your districting. Is that not right? Dale Schultz.
Oh, yeah. Dale and Tim were going around talking about a different way to
do it. So a lot of Republicans just understand your district as well, at least one.
Yeah.
Right. But the question is, specifically, you gave the water well as an example of where local control is being infringed upon. What are the other three top areas in your brain where the Republicans are saying, we're for local and taking away the power at the same time?
That's water wells. Cost controls and local units of government. Cost controls on local school districts. When you can and can't have referendums. Certain zoning issues. Those are just a few. One more quick question.
Do you have any, this might be premature given the news in the last 24 hours, do you have any thoughts on this Department of Transportation issue that's jumping up here at us all of a sudden?
The fact that we don't have any money? Well, okay, so there's a couple of things in the audit that you're talking about. The audit was done by the Legislative Audit Bureau, and it showed two things that really jump out at me. Number one is our futures projects, where all the big projects that have been cited into the future, haven't started yet, are already $3 billion in the hole because they didn't factor in inflation. The other thing that really jumped out to me was that within a five-year span, 5 years of time, our roads went from 53% of them good to 41% of them good. I don't have to tell you about the roads around here. They get up to the
bridges.
Oh yeah, bridges too. You get up to the northern part of my Senate district on 188, which is goes up by the Merrimack Ferry, West Point, over by Sauk City, and so on. It's really bad. 78's bad. 33's bad. Town roads are really taking a beating because they weren't, not because they weren't built to standards, they were, they just weren't built to handle this kind of traffic that they're getting. County roads, my gosh. So the governor has said he will not raise taxes unless there's a corresponding cut in spending. So we haven't raised the gas tax in 11 years. We haven't raised new revenue for transportation, essentially, in 11 years. And the governor's plan for the transportation budget is to borrow more money, and we already pay about 20 cents on the dollar to debt service to pay for money that we've already borrowed, and then put projects on hold, except not the Verona Road interchange, but other projects around the state, put them on hold. I'm telling you now, we need to raise the gas tax. It needs to go up a nickel, and we need to put what's called indexing back on the books. Now, that's not the end-all be-all, because we have to have a long-term discussion on transportation, because there are more fuel-efficient vehicles on the road today. There are more hybrids. There are electric vehicles. So in the long run, we'll be collecting less in gas tax. So we need to figure out a way to pay for the roads. And I'm telling you right now, in my opinion, tolling, by the way, is not the answer. It's $300 to $400 million to start up tolling, and you need permission from the federal government. And then there's no guarantee that any legislator will give me that we will never sell the tolling rights to a company. That's what happens in some states. You build the toll, then you do the quick cash grab, you sell the tolling rights to some companies, in some cases foreign entities, and they now own the tolls. And they essentially, hang on, gotta take a picture. they own the tolls. Now, what we could do, if you want to, is along the border, the Illinois border, we could just put out a couple of baskets. And some Illinois people might just out of habit might just. So I tell you what, transportation will be the toughest issue that we deal with as far as the dollars and cents go. And I would not be surprised if transportation doesn't pass when it should. Because the governor won't raise taxes. There are Republicans who voted against borrowing that much money last time. So I'm curious to see what's going to happen to it, but to be honest with you, we really, for the time being, to get us out of, we have $1 billion deficit in transportation now, in addition to the $3 billion down the road, no pun intended, but we need to get new revenue in there right away, and you can't be pro-job and have the kind of roads that we have. Yeah. It's hypocritical. To say that we're open for business, and oh, by the way, stay off our roads. You know, so. All right, yeah, enjoy the movie.